Good morning. Welcome to our contemporary worship service here at Center Church. Thank you for joining us today here in person and out there in Facebook land. Please join me in my opening prayer. Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for the opportunity to gather here today to worship you and to show our appreciation for your saving grace. Thank you for your everlasting love and for showing us how deep that love is by sending your only son, Jesus, to pay our sin debt so that we can all have the chance to enjoy true freedom through his sacrifice. Please let our ears hear Pastor Mitch's message, our minds understand that message, and may our hearts be filled by the Holy Spirit. And please look after our mission trip crew as they travel back from Savannah today. In Christ's name, amen.
Let us stand and sing "He is Exalted," and the words will be on the screen for you.
Forever His truth will reign. Thank you, Molly and Marty. We're so glad to have them with us the last 2 weeks as our other leader, glorious leader, is down in Savannah coming back as well. If you have your Bibles and would today I'm going to be talking about we hold back the most, and maybe that we're the greediest the most, is forgiveness being offered to other people. And sometimes it's not altogether our fault, but it's just because of the depth of how we've been hurt in our lives. And I want to give that as a disclaimer before I ever get started this morning. In a place this big and that many people out there watching, I can't imagine saying that up front, what I'm talking about today is the forgiveness that only Jesus Christ can do through you. You can't do it on your own. It's a work of God. And so I want you to be thinking about that as we preach this morning. We're going to change out just a second, I think. We're going to stay right where we're at. You're about to see one handsome fella come up here. A fella. Now, how's that? Okay. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 through 13. Hear the reading of God's Word. Paul writes, "Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with one another, each other, and forgive one another if any of you has a grievance against someone. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity." This is a word of God for you, the people of God. Thanks be to God. Father, we just come before you, inviting your great work in our life, this work of grace, of forgiveness. God, we confess that we can't forgive on our own. There's things that people have done to us and been so hurtful to us that we can only do that through your power. So, Lord, this morning, before we ever hear the rest of the preaching, we invite your Holy Spirit to come and work in our life, that we might be the people of God you call us to be. In Jesus' name, amen. I was at another church many years ago, and I met this dear woman, and she was just so precious to our family. She was really a loving person, but yet she was a hard person. You could just see it in her. You could see that she was one of these people had lived rough. You know what I mean? She had had a tough life. And after we started getting to know her a little better, I found out that her mother was a lady who loved fishing. She'd go fishing every opportunity she had at a nearby lake, which was only from her house, like about a mile. She'd go fishing, and she'd stay all day down at that lake. It was kind of a secluded area, but she'd still go. The family had warned her, she'd still go. One evening, some of the family came in to visit with Mama. Mama wasn't at home. They searched everywhere. They made all the calls. You know how you do. And then before long, you realize something bad's happened. They went down to the old fishing hole, and they found where Mama had been terribly, terribly murdered. In fact, not only had she been murdered, there'd been another person in a nearby community murdered by a young man who had a lot of problems. And it devastated that family. It terrorized the community. The weeks turned into months, and then was the trial. And you think, well, the trial, this will kind of wrap it up, be able to give you a little bit of closure. You know, that's what people say. You see it on TV. We need some closure. She never got the closure. Boy was sent off to prison, still in prison today. Now, the tragedy of the story I'm about to tell you is that this dear woman, every time this young man's up for parole, she was the one who would go all the way to Raleigh for the parole hearing. And she would go, and she'd represent her feelings and her family and her mama's memory, because she felt like this boy needed to stay in prison. And are you ready? He did need to stay in prison. What she did needed to happen. But what was so hard for that woman was that this boy was in prison, but the lady I'm telling you this story about, she was in a darker prison. A prison that no bars could hold her, no government legislative act could set her free. She was the prisoner. And she lived that life up to a few years ago. It's ironic that the very things that she needed to be able to do, she couldn't get do on her own. And she contracted or inherited Alzheimer's. And that set her free from that terrible memory. And ultimately, a few years ago, death. She couldn't forgive that boy. She couldn't forgive him. Today, folks, I want to talk to you about forgiveness. And frankly, not a thing. Satan's going to be whispering in your ear, so I'm going to jump the gun for him. Nothing I say makes any sense. Except, again, through the power of Jesus Christ. Why do we need to forgive? Well, here, right quick, let me look at it. Colossians chapter 3. Look what he does. He lifts out all these different areas that they had been forgiven as the people of God. Paul reaches out to the Colossians and he lifts out all these things they'd been forgiven of. What? They've been forgiven of sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, greed, anger, slander, rage, filthy language, lying. They'd been forgiven of all that stuff. And because they'd been forgiven of all that stuff, they had been clothed as new creatures in Christ, Peter's reminding them. Hey, that's the way you've been forgiven. You've been forgiven of that stuff too. Every single one of us. You lift that stuff out. And the funny thing is, none of that's real specific, is it? It's kind of vague, some of that stuff. Sexual immorality. What's that? You know what it is. See? I know what it is. Doesn't have to be lifted out specifically, does it? Not a legal document. We know where we've sinned. We know about the rage we've had. We know how we've had problems with pride, greed, you name it. He lifts it all out, doesn't he? And says that we've been forgiven. That's the neat thing about it. We've been forgiven. He says, and have put on, verse 10, the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. We're being renewed in the image of the creator. I want you to think about that with forgiveness just a minute. God is renewing you constantly. You're not what you ought to be yet, right? I mean, you really aren't what you ought to be yet. We're growing in that grace. Growing in that grace. Constantly growing in it. We're not where we ought to be yet. You know, it's amazing when you see, if you hadn't been around, it happens to me a lot from being at various churches, and somebody will come up to me, I'll be somewhere, and they'll start talking to me, and they'll say, you know who I am? And I'm going, no, I don't know who you are. And they'll start talking, and then there's suddenly little Johnny that's now 17 years old. You see, I still think he ought to be right here, right? But he's grown up. That's the way we are. We're growing up. We're growing up, not in our image, but in the image of God. God's constantly renewing that. That's the work and the washing of the Holy Spirit, constantly transforming us. This whole thing of grace and walking to look more like Jesus, it's a constant journey. It's a constant journey. And God's continuing to work in our life, so much so that it's such a constant journey. We realize what God's doing. Guess what? He's doing that in a lot of other people's lives too. We realize that who we are is in Him, not in who we are. It's what He's doing in us, in spite of us. And that's the marvelous thing about God's grace, is that He gives that to all people. Isn't that wonderful? God gives that to all people. Doesn't matter what the color of your skin is. Doesn't matter your nationality. It doesn't matter. God's giving it out to all of you. Do you realize right now today in a place called Seoul, South Korea, that there's folks worshiping the living God today? There's some folks on the continent of Africa that are underneath. Now, there's a lot of them in some fine churches, so don't get me wrong. I'm not prejudging. I'm just saying there is some bushmen and women gathering under some little trees in some other places in Africa today. There's some places here in America that they're gathering in little old churches, and I've preached in them where you walk in the door, it feels like the ceiling's about that high. Have you ever been in any little churches like that? They'll have about 20 pews down through there, and the further you walk, it feels like you're closed in because it's built in like an old house or something. You ever been in one of them? Well, that's the way some people are meeting today in the basements of their houses all over this country. The great house movement going on throughout the world. There are folks just like us. And this is what Paul reminds us about. There's no Gentile or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. You see, because of what He's done, that brings us all together. Doesn't matter what you are, man, woman, beast, brings us together, right? Brings us together. And see, because of that, let me get off on some stuff that's happening politically, because it's amazing to me how the Bible keeps speaking to me. I don't have to apologize for being a white folk. I don't. I don't have to apologize for being a little fella lived in Marion. I've told this tale before. My mom and daddy, my daddy worked in the cotton mill. Then he went to Drexel Furniture. He really moved up. Instead of breathing cotton dust, he breathed the old furniture dust where he sanded it down to get it ready to go in the finishing department. That's where my daddy and mama lived, just whole hard-working people. But see, that doesn't make me any more righteous than the folks down the street that had all kind of money. Are you with me? See, it's the same. You had to get to my house, you had to go through the section called Black Bottom to get to our house. Those folks are just as precious, different color of skin, as the folks that lived out in my community. Or on the other side of town, the wealthy folks. You see, when you come back to church, you gather in the same place because we're the people of God, because of what God's done at the cross. That's what brings us together, folks. There's no amount of political action can bring our country together again except the cross. The cross. Because at the cross, the ground's level, and all are in need of God's forgiveness and grace. The whole world stands in need of God's grace. You're watching me, wherever you're at, whoever you are, you're in need of God's grace just like everybody else. And you're very precious to Him. Because, see, He's done all this other work of grace, and then He turns and says this to us. After you go all this, you see, you're the holy people. You're dearly loved. Clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility. See, all that other clothes that you used to be wearing, you're going to put on some new clothes. Clothe yourself with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another as if you have any grievance against one another. Forgive one another. And then He says, the last verse, part of verse 13, forgive as the Lord forgave you. Wow. You see, that's different than oftentimes I forgive. You know, it's funny, and I don't know when it changed in my life, but I used to didn't have any trouble with forgiveness. I just didn't. It's not that I'm holy, not that I'm better than everybody. I just didn't have that trouble. But somewhere along the way, stuff started just creeping into my life that I hadn't dealt with, or not that I hadn't dealt with. Frankly, let me say this to you. The problems you're having with forgiveness is because you're dealing with them. You're dealing with them. Are you letting God deal with them? Because you see, I was finding out all this stuff I was dealing with, and I couldn't take care of it. A number of years ago, we were traveling back home, and I won't get into details because I don't know where this is going to end up, but it was Christmas. I love Christmas, but I'll be very honest with you, family makes Christmas tough. Can somebody in this house say amen? See, I have no problem with what Jesus did for me and makes Christmas special, but gosh, some of this trappings, it bugs me anymore. I understand why people go to Disney World at Christmas. It's worth the money. And we were traveling home. I can tell you exactly where I was at. I was on Interstate 40, where 221 comes underneath in Marion. And it hit me like a ton of bricks. I looked over at Beth. I said, I don't want to go home. And it was like a flood of stuff just coming, just roaring out of me. I mean, it was like an old volcano that just, man, the anger, the old rot. I mean, there wasn't anything good in that, you know, just flood me. And you know what it was? It's just a bunch of stuff that I hadn't let go and let God forgive. Because you're going to deal with it. You're going to deal with it. Why do you think when you're trying to go to Winston-Salem, there's so many people try to run you off the road and blow at you? I mean, really. I was making a little road trip the other day to Boone, twice in the same day within an hour or two. I stop at a red light. Now, folks, when that red light turns green, I don't have to burn the rubber to take off, okay? I just don't. I'm not in a drag race. If I was in a drag race, I thought that light had changed, I'd burn the rubber off the Tahoe, okay? But no. I don't do that because I'm not in a drag race. But somebody invariably behind me will blow the horn because I hadn't took off in a millisecond quick enough. And what does that do? It makes me just love them so much. And I just rain down the blessings of God upon their car, don't you? The truth is, if there's a button and it said a heat-seeking missile, I'd fire that missile. That'd be the end of that little old Tahoe or little Toyota behind me, whatever that little thing is. But there's so many people angry on the road. I mean, you're driving down the road, and they're always telling me I'm number one. It just amazes me. I just love it. They just love me. I just like it. People so angry. Folks, he said, forgive as I forgive you. Now, how much do we need to forgive? I got to wrap all this stuff. How much do I need to forgive? The Bible says that there was that Peter asked Jesus one day, he said, how much do I need to forgive? Just how much do I need to do with this? Because we want to know, don't we? How much is enough before I can slap them down? How much is enough, right? Peter says, Lord, how much is enough? 7 times? He said, no, 70 times 7. Now, add that 490 times. Is that what he was really saying? No. Jesus was saying, forgive indefinitely. And he said, hey, Peter, let me tell you a story. This man came to the Lord came to this man one day collecting his debts. This master who had owned it all came and collecting his debts. And he went to this particular man and he said, you owe me a bunch of gold. A bunch of gold. I mean, I think it's like 20 years worth of gold, something like that. You owe me all this gold. In Matthew chapter 18. And the man started crying and whining. Oh, I don't have a lawyer that's big enough and strong enough to get me. I don't do that, and my family needs me. Don't throw me. He said, yeah, you're going to prison. Now, don't do that. Oh, it's so awful. Please forgive me. Please forgive me. And the Lord forgave him. The Lord forgave him. Every bit of his debt. Isn't that a great story? Of God's forgiveness. God forgave him of all of it. You think, man, that fella's going to grow up and do right himself, right? What does he do? He gets out of prison. He goes to thinking about some stuff because he's wanting to get him a new boat to go fishing down High Rock Lake. And he goes to thinking, I got some folks that owe me some money. I'm going to go to old Fred. Fred owes me a bunch of money and he hadn't paid me. So he goes to old Fred. True story. Goes to Fred and says, I want all that silver you owed me. It was a small amount. I want it. The man said, there's no way I can pay you what I owe you. Then he had him beat and thrown into prison. The master, the Lord, found out about it and went to him. Do you not remember what I done for you? Think about all I did for you. I canceled out all that big debt. And you wouldn't do that for that man? You wouldn't do that for old Fred? And then this is what Jesus says. Jesus says, this is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart. Wow, that's hard stuff. I mean, that got from the fun and games of the drag race to our life, didn't it? Jesus said, you've got to forgive people from your heart like I forgive you from my heart. How much is that? Well, John tells us in the 8th chapter of John, about a woman, you remember, who's caught in the very act of adultery by these men. Do you remember that story? Caught in the very act of adultery. Now, let me get this down where we can understand this a minute. Do you know what these men had done to catch her in the very act? See, going over to Applebee's with this woman isn't an act of adultery, is it? Just nod your head. Shake your head. No, they're peeping in the windows. Wow, aren't they great neighbors to have? They're peeping. They saw a little Volkswagen pull up in the yard, and they said, oh, that's Frida over at John's house. Come on. And they went and start peeping in the windows. Folks, that's what they did. They saw what happened. They bring her out of that house. No telling what kind of condition she's in. I mean, honestly. And they bring her to Jesus, wanting to twist him up in something. But we won't get into that all together. But interesting enough, there's no dude. Yeah, there's the nosy neighbors, but there's no dude that was committing the act with her. Wow. Isn't that sweet? The woman will carry the whole load. And by the way, she's going to get stoned to death. I mean, this is big stuff. It's kind of funny. But then you say, oh, she got stoned to death. Well, no, this ain't good stuff. This is different than as the world turns stuff. And the young and the restless. She's going to die. And Jesus hears all these charges against the woman. And this great rabbi begins to, he gets down on his maybe one knee, and he starts writing in the sand. Now, we don't know what he's writing in the sand. It just says he starts writing in the sand. What in the world? Now, some theologians say that Jesus is writing the sins of these different men that's standing around. And as they see their name and they see the sin out from it, they take off. We don't know what he's doing. Whatever it is, the crowd leaves. And Jesus gets up, raises his eyes up to this woman she's just gripped with tears and heartache and anger, fear, betrayal, all this mess. And Jesus looks at her and says, where's your condemner at? And she looks around probably for the first time and realizes, wow, we're by ourselves. And Jesus said to her, neither do I condemn you. Those that are condemning you, they're gone. Neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. What an act of grace. So how do I forgive? I don't offer condemnation anymore. See, that's what forgiveness really is. Now, let me get this around just because I've got to wrap this thing up, tie it up some kind of way. Forgiveness isn't this good, warm, squishy feeling that you can get whoever's wronged you and go sing around the maypole and sing Jesus loves us. That's not what forgiveness is. Forgiveness is coming to the place that you don't condemn them because you've given them to the Lord. The very first sermon we preached in this series on generosity, do you remember what it was? That God owns everything in the heavens and earth. God owns that problem. God owns the person that's done you wrong. Give it to him. Folks, just to be honest with you, you can't deal with somebody like the Lord can deal with them. Have you ever felt like you were under the condemnation of God? Have you ever felt like that God was through the Holy Spirit convicting you of sin? Have you ever been to that place? Wow, me too. And there's nothing more miserable. You can't sleep. You're just unsettled. Hey, give them to the Lord. Because the person that you are having the most problem with forgiving, let me tell you, they're living their life. And that maybe is the rub to you. Right? And you just assume them not be living their life. You'd rather them be miserable, sitting up in Lexington in a chair, sitting there with a tag, this is what I did to Kathy. And it's stained right there. That suits you fine, wouldn't it? But that's not God's grace. See, God doesn't condemn you. And in the same way, you need to offer that to somebody else. Now, how are you going to do that? How in the world does human beings do it? The truth is you can't. See, I can't. And you can't. And there's no magical formula. There's no dust I can put on your head and send you out of here. But it's what you have to ask the Holy Spirit to do in your life. You have to ask Him to forgive. Make it today the beginning of that step of grace. You remember I talked earlier about how grace is a progression? Today, start lifting them up in prayer. Say, you do not know what they did to me. No. I said, and I will say again in all these services, it's never failed every place I've ever been that people don't come to me and talk about how they've been molested, for instance. And to me, that's one of the worst things that can happen to you. And you still live. To me, that's a murder that you're having to live with. You're shot mortally, but you're still having to walk around. And that's something I don't know. I've just seen it, and I know enough about it. That's a pretty tough thing. Then you pray for that person that done that to you. You give them to the Jesus, to the Lord of the cross. Because, folks, listen, if he can't forgive that person what they did to you, he can't forgive you what you've done to him. Did you catch that? See, if his grace isn't sufficient to deal with whatever they've done to you, God can't forgive you for what you've done. But remember that long list of stuff, the lust, the impurity, the greed, the angers, and all other stuff God's done for you? God can still do that in your life. He wants to set you free because you need to be free. You need to be free. You don't need to be like that woman I told you about the first of the sermon. You need to be set free. You don't need to be in prison. You don't deserve that. Let me say this to you. You're loved and you deserve to know you're loved. And oftentimes the things that's happened to you, you don't feel like you can be loved. Let me tell you, the cross says, I love you. God says, I love you. There's a story told in one of the South American countries. A daddy's son had run off and wasted his life on drugs and God knows what else. And it had been a bitter break when the son left. And the daddy was heartbroken. And the daddy wrote posters and put them out. Paco, or whatever his name was, said, you can come home. That's all it said. You know what? Give a date for him to come home and the place. And outside that newspaper place that morning, over 800 young men by that name showed up because they knew they could come back home. You can too. You can too. Yes, you've been hurt. You've been stomped on. You've been mistreated. Things have been said about you. You need to be able to set that person free too because you deserve freedom in Jesus' name. That's what this church stuff's all about, folks. That's what the cross is about. Father God, thank you that we can find forgiveness in you. God, as we gather here today, we gather as a pretty motley crew, Lord. We've been beat up, drugged down the road sometimes, and Lord, some others have done some heinous things. God, we begin today by lifting this soul to you that's hurt us. God, help us to forgive them. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you on this very difficult walk of grace. Thank you for coming today.
Let us stand and close with Shine, Jesus, Shine. On that. I don't know what happened, but anyway, let us close with prayer. Father God, we thank you for each person here today in our church. We thank you, God, for Mitch's message on forgiveness, how powerful. We thank you, Lord, for all our abundant blessings, as we are so unworthy, and we just thank you, Lord. Now, as we go forth this week, Lord, help us to be mindful of your presence in our lives. In thy name we pray. Amen.